how the brain works. Neither do I, but it is my quest to study it. And when people hear that I study the brain, the first thing they ask me is it true that we only use 10% of our brain? See, according to myth, there's 90% of brain that we're not using. It's just waiting to be used. So is it so? My answer will be a little bit disappointing. We use all our brain, all 100% of it. And if you were to lose 90% of your brain, it would be noticeable. But let's replace that fallacy with some real numbers. Only 10% of the inputs into the brain arise directly from our senses, from our eyes seeing, from our ears hearing. The rest is what I like to call brain chatter. It's stuff that's going on that is removed from the outside world, but rather is shaped by connections and computations, different areas in the brain that are talking to each other. I study this 90% of brain chatter, and my hope is to understand better how we perceive, how we attend, basically how we experience the world. Take a look at this image here. Three Pac-Men is all that's there. There are no lines connecting the Pac-Men, and no surface laid on top of them. Yet we all can't help but see a triangle, an object that isn't there. How about this face here? It's a bit strange. It's a morph. It's a morph. It's 50% Obama and 50% Bush. We can call him Bubama. Take a look at Obama. Take a look at Bubama. I'm going to now transition to Obama, as you're used to seeing him. And I'm going to ask you to please take a look at him. Stare at him as long as I allow you to. Because in a few moments, after we're done looking at Obama, I will bring Bubama back, and this time around, he's going to look a little different. So, an extra moment to stare at Obama. Here you go. It's an identical picture of Bubama, but your brain now has a different history. It has a different history. It's seen what Obama looks like, and now Bubama looks a lot like Bush. So, 90% brain chatter is what makes us see objects that are not there. It's what makes us see an identical face differently the second time round. So brain chatter is also responsible for a very important ability we have. It's our mega filter, without which we could not function. And it probably has to do with the reason that TED Talks are getting shorter and shorter as years go by. It's attention. Humans have an incredible ability to only select things that are relevant to what they need. That is what we call attention. So imagine you're at the fairground. Lots going on. There's noises, lights. Kids are screaming in terror from the rides or laughing with joy and, of course, jumping crazily from the sugar rush. It's complete overstimulation. But the amazing fact is, we are able to figure out where our attention should go. If I take my five-year-old to this fairground and put her in front of a sweet cotton candy treat, that is what she will devote her attention to. The rest of the world, the bustle, the noise, the lights, they reach her senses, but they're practically absent from her experience. She's one with the cotton candy. So, how does attention work? How does the brain dim out everything else except for that cotton candy? We can answer this question by looking at brain dynamics. We could also answer this question by measuring behavior. And the two, of course, are related. When we pay attention to one thing, different parts of the brain that are processing it are communicating. So, in the case of cotton candy, we have areas in the brain that identify its pink color, other areas in the brain that identify its form, and of course, areas that store memories of how great it tastes. All those areas are engaged in vigorous communication, in brain chatter. The rest of the bustle, it's unattended, and so there's far less brain chatter associated with it. Now, in behavior, even when we're focusing on one thing, turns out that attention isn't working constantly at the same level. So we're looking at the cotton candy, we're experiencing it continuously, where in fact, if I were to measure behavior carefully, what actually is happening is we have better moments and worse moments. There are moments where we can see the cotton candy better with our brains, and moments where we're barely seeing it. And these transitions between those better moments and worse moments occur around 8 times a second. This, again, sounds a bit strange, probably, because, as I said, we all experience our environment continuously. You might wonder, are there any conditions under which we could experience these transitions, this rhythm that occurs 8 times a second? So there's a group of researchers in Toulouse, France, that figured out that there's some configurations in which we can all experience the rhythm that shapes our experience. We can see the rhythm that shapes our experience. So take a look at this wheel behind me. Focus on the blue dot. At some point, it will start moving, and I would like to ask you to track the dot as it's revolving around the wheel. What do you see? Most of you should perceive something strange going on at the center of the wheel, something that is flickering, something that is rhythmic. So these kind of stimuli allow us, momentarily, or under these very special conditions, to experience this rhythm. Let's go back to the fairground. Our reality is much more complex than paying attention to one thing. There are many things that are occurring in our environment that require our attention. A question that interested me is this rhythm of attention a hardwired feature? Is that all we have, 8 good moments a second? Or is attention and the brain a flexible tool that adjusts depending on the needs of our environment? If I want to go to the fun fair with both my girls, I want both of them to go on their favorite ride at the same time, am I going to be able to pay attention to both of them just as well as if I were there with one child? I found a way to test that in the lab. I had people view 2 things on a screen and monitor them for a subtle change in one of them. They had to distribute their attention. What I found was that the same rhythm that is key in paying attention to one object was now distributed over these 2 locations. Not only that, it was alternating between the 2 regions, between the 2 objects. So it was a little bit like a seesaw, if you will. So back to the fairground again. If I'm there with both my girls, then paying attention to both of them, in essence, means I'm going to be alternating between the 2 different rides to pay attention to them. The same rhythm that plays a role in paying attention to one object is the rhythm that also governs attention to more complex scenes, 2 objects, and even 3 objects. Another surprising fact that I found was that when I looked at all the individuals that came to my experiments, the rhythm was rather consistent. Attention is a hardwired and consistent feature, and seeing this consistency made me realize that perhaps it's similar to other exploration behaviors in the animal kingdom. Turns out that also rodents whisk and sniff at that rhythm. Primates move their eyes at that rhythm. So we're looking at a rather consistent phenomenon, and in this context, you could think of attention as an exploration behavior in humans. So my research comes with some good news and some bad news. Bad news are that when you are driving your car and conducting a conversation at the same time, your resources are limited, and they are alternating between the conversation, the road, the conversation, the road. That's happening 8 times a second. And it doesn't really matter if you're talking through a headset, through the speakerphone, or if you're holding the phone in your hand. When you are paying attention to the conversation, you're not paying attention to the road. The good news are we might be able to use this discovery that attention is a rhythm in the clinic. So there's many conditions that are characterized by a deficit in attention. ADD, affective disorders, stroke, just to name a few. If a rhythm is a hardwired feature of attention, we might think of these disorders as what I like to call brain arrhythmia. Cases where the intact rhythm of attention is disrupted. Moreover, if indeed attention deficits stem from brain arrhythmia, we need to think about attention pacemakers. Perhaps we could regulate the correct rhythms. Think about it as if it's a rhythmic gymnastic class for the brain. So I ask you now to imagine a stroke patient in a ward wearing headphones that are emitting rhythmic clicks. And those rhythmic clicks are teaching the brain what the correct rhythm of attention is. We could do even better if we use shutter glasses that are emitting and exposing the world rhythmically to our patients. We could make sure that the sensory input is making it to our senses at the appropriate rhythm. So by studying attention, I was able to discover that what we called brain chatter at first is not quite a random brain chatter, but rather a meaningful conversation. If 90% of brain chatter actually hides within it meaningful conversations, we have a quest when we approach the study of the brain. Our quest is to listen to brain chatter, to decode the underlying structures that are there, and by doing that, we can start a frontier in understanding ourselves and understanding how the brain works. Thank you.